Good afternoon, everyone. We have a lot to get through today, including modeling, testing in schools. We're also going to hear from Dr. Rebecca Bell, the president of the Vermont chapter of the American Academy of Pediatrics. First, last week I announced a new Vermont partnership with NIH and Amazon that will allow us to deliver rapid tests directly to the homes of Vermonters. Through this program, we've acquired about 500,000 tests, which is about 250,000 kits. Tomorrow, we'll launch the website so that Vermonters can go online and place their order. Households will be able to request no more than 2 kits, which is 4 tests, and we fully expect them to go quickly. As I said in the announcement last week, this is a pilot program we've been working on with our federal partners for about a month. This is also in addition to, not in place of, President Biden's initiative to send tests to Americans, which is expected to begin later this month. It's also in addition to the rapid tests that we've devoted to schools. As we also announced last week, child care programs will now be eligible to implement Test to Stay and can sign up and get their tests through the Department of Children and Families. Rapid tests continue to be an important tool, especially given what we've learned about Omicron. While PCR tests are still beneficial, they take too long in many instances to prevent further spread due to the speed in which Omicron transmits. That's also why, based on the science and data, and in coordination with the Vermont's top pediatricians and infectious disease experts, the state is changing its guidance for dealing with COVID in schools. The process we've been using with school nurses acting as contact tracers was effective pre-Omicron, but it no longer is as effective as it once was. The new approach will get more tests out by treating everyone in a classroom where there's been a positive case as a contact, instead of how they previously defined close contacts. This means everyone in the class would be notified of a positive case, and rapid tests would be distributed to those who have gotten them through Test to Stay. Now, I know on social media, some, including some fellow politicians, claim we were reducing testing or doing away with it altogether. This is just not the case, and it's unfortunate they weighed in before having the facts. Again, the change will increase access to testing and increase notifications. As Dr. Levine will describe, Omicron makes this shift essential to supporting school operations and preventing further spread. Finally, as we see what's happening across the country and the Northeast, it's clear cases will continue to increase for a while. Although Vermont leads the nation in vaccinations, and as a result, we have one of the lowest hospitalization rates and death rates in the country right now, it's not enough. Please make sure getting a booster is a top priority for you and your family. It's not too late. Anyone 12 and older is eligible. As we said for months, vaccination is the best way to protect yourself and others, but taking additional precautions is also important, like wearing a mask indoors, staying home when sick, and using testing as a tool. With that, I'll turn it over to Secretary French.
Thank you, Governor. Good afternoon. On Friday, we announced we'd be making a shift in our mitigation strategies for schools, mainly changes to both contact tracing and testing. I thought I'd start off today by explaining some of the background on that decision and its announcement. There were 2 basic variables behind this decision: an evaluation of school operational capacity and public health considerations. From an operations perspective, we've had some concern for some time about the ability of school staff to sustain contact tracing. These concerns became more acute as we implemented test to stay, since nurses are essentially directly in charge of supervising both of those processes in schools. And I think, as everyone's aware, Vermont was an early adopter in test to stay, which proved to be a very successful strategy at the height of the Delta surge in containing the virus, but also allowing a larger number of students to stay in school. But when we opened schools after the holiday, unfortunately, at the beginning of the surge, the new Omicron variant, it was clear we were going to have to make some adjustments, both to contact tracing and testing, since Omicron was spreading so much faster, and our processes of contact tracing and test to stay had difficulty keeping up. Last week, our decision-making came to a pivotal moment when our public health team concluded that contact tracing and surveillance testing were not going to be as effective against Omicron. We then factored in the operational strain of continuing what we were doing and concluded that we needed to make a shift. I outlined that shift for the first time last week in my regular weekly call with superintendents on Thursday. And on Friday, I previewed our decision with the leadership of all the major education associations, including the School Board Association, the Superintendents Association, the Principals Association, and Vermont NEA. Those conversations led me to publish an advisory email to superintendents, independent school heads, and school district COVID-19 coordinators late in the day on Friday, outlining the shift in policy and stating that more information would be coming out this week. I also met with Vermont NEA leadership and its Board of Trustees on Saturday morning. They had many questions about the public health rationale for these changes, and I encouraged them to hold their public health questions until this week, when Dr. Levine and his team could be available to address them, as they've done throughout the pandemic. I wanted to outline the decision-making and the communications on this, since it has been characterized as abrupt. And to a certain extent, I think that is a fair characterization. Omicron is forcing us to move quicker than we might otherwise have wanted, but as I mentioned, both from an operational perspective and a public health perspective, we concluded we needed to make a shift, and we needed to make that change sooner rather than later. My announcement on Friday could have contained more specificity, so I thought I would explain exactly what this shift will mean for our schools and our communities, and also provide an update on some of the work we've been doing this week to enact that change. General description of the change is that contact tracing in schools as we knew it will stop in favor of the process the governor described of a response notification to parents that includes recommendations for testing depending on the vaccination status of the students. The antigen testing in schools will shift from what we used to call test to stay, where schools administered the tests on site, to an approach where schools will distribute the antigen tests to families and staff for administration at home. Both the response notification and the use of antigen testing will be closely tied to our updated recommendations on quarantine and isolation. A key variable for implementing this new system will be testing supplies. Schools will be receiving deliveries of additional test kits this week. So earlier today, we put out an advisory to superintendents and independent school heads and COVID coordinators that they can transition to this new system when they feel they have an adequate supply of tests to do so, which I expect for many schools will be later this week. Our next steps will be to update our guidance documents and related communications tools for schools, such as the letter templates they use to communicate notification of a case. That work is underway. We're working closely with the leadership of the School Nurses Association and other stakeholder groups to develop those tools to maximize their utility to people that work in the schools. So this is an important transition in our response to the pandemic. We've been through several other transitions in the past, so I'm confident we'll be successful. I do appreciate everyone's patience as we work through these moments and the details of implementing the new system. Lastly, I wanted to speak to the issue of school attendance waivers. These waivers pertain to the number of days each year that schools are required to be in session for students. A session day for a school is defined when a majority of its students are present for school instruction. Going remote does not count as a session day. This means schools are either open or closed. If they are closed more days than the minimum allows, they need to make the days up or get a waiver. The waiver process will begin later this month. The waiver process is outlined in our regulation and is designed to be implemented in the second half of the school year. The State Board has given me authority to review these waivers again this year. I'll be publishing an expedited waiver process soon for school closures that are related to COVID-19 conditions. I intend to be as flexible as possible with these waivers as I've done so in the last 2 years of the pandemic. That concludes my update. I'll now turn it over to Dr. Levine.
Thanks, Secretary French. I'd like to start out by saying that I know what a difficult time this is. Probably the most disruptive month we will have endured. We're navigating yet another phase of this pandemic, seeing a surge of cases from a much more contagious variant. I've spoken many times up here about how unfortunately the virus is not going away, but will eventually become endemic. Like other respiratory viruses, we'll have enough immunity that it can circulate without huge spikes in cases, hospitalizations, or deaths. We hope this difficult transition period will ultimately help us get to a time when we can live with this virus much more easily. As we've been doing all along in the pandemic, we use data and science to make real-time adjustments in our approach. Omicron is no exception, and its pace makes it even more important to be nimble. And I understand how challenging this has been for our children. The virus has impacted their education, their sports and play, and not any less, the lives and jobs of their parents and that of their teachers and school staff. It is the defining characteristics of the Omicron variant that form the backdrop for why a change in our school guidance makes sense now. The variant's highly contagious, it has a shorter incubation period, and so spreads rapidly through the population. The good news is that it does seem to cause less severe outcomes, especially in our youth. That is why we're evolving our contact tracing for schools to be more expansive in who gets notified when there is a case, so we can move faster to respond. And we're using rapid tests so we can move more quickly to isolate those who need to stay home and reduce the risk of further spread. Our North Star continues to be preserving in-person education for our youth, keeping kids who should be in school in school. We keep learning from this virus in real time, building on our experience to date. That is why I'm here to present our updated approach, which builds on data and scientific rationale. And our pediatric colleagues are overwhelmingly in favor of this approach. The speed at which Omicron moves and spreads means that some of our current tools have been rendered less effective. We need to move faster to counter this variant. Our new strategies are designed to be more effective, lessening the burden of work on school personnel. First, contact tracing will evolve from its currently rather slow and labor-intensive nature, somewhat outdated and outpaced by Omicron, to one that still accomplishes the essential task of notifying possible contacts. Once a positive case is identified in a class, all the students in that class are considered contacts. This is a more conservative approach that is faster and more comprehensive. Second, we are continuing the evolution to a more rapid testing system. PCR surveillance testing, while it may still be utilized by schools if they so desire, is too slow to respond to this new variant in the school setting. We believe PCR surveillance testing has lost much of its value. Moving to an antigen testing system at this time of high community transmission will be far more responsive. Schools will be able to distribute test kits to unvaccinated students so they can test daily for 5 consecutive days, and if negative, can stay in class. Test kits can also be provided to asymptomatic vaccinated students who do not need to quarantine but may want to test at day 3, 4, or 5. Test kits can also be provided to vaccinated or unvaccinated staff, and even to students who are identified as close contacts outside of the school. By layering this science-based and simpler approach on all the other mitigation strategies being followed in our schools, like wearing masks indoors and staying home if you're sick, we can keep our schools as safe as possible and keep more children in in-person education, which is the core priority. I acknowledge we are shifting some of the responsibility to homes, but this will actually help parents and caregivers make decisions about illness and likelihood of COVID every day. Families deserve the certainty of knowing their child's status before they leave the house, not when their child gets to the school. And the state's school nurses, who have moved mountains day after day throughout the pandemic, will then be able to be present for testing and evaluating students who become ill in the school. Beyond schools, I want to repeat and remind everyone about the quarantine and isolation guidelines because they're still rather new. The isolation period is the time following your positive test or when your symptoms began. Quarantine, on the other hand, follows your exposure to an infected person when you are a close contact, but may or may not become infected. If you have COVID, the isolation period is now 5 days, followed by 5 days of wearing a mask when around others, if you meet certain conditions. Either you never had symptoms, or your symptoms have improved and you feel better, and you had no fever for the past 24 hours. We also strongly recommend having 2 negative antigen tests performed at least 24 hours apart, beginning no earlier than day 4. And of course, remembering to notify your close contacts. You can get all this guidance at healthvermont.gov/COVID-19-positive. Now for quarantine, certain people do not need to quarantine. You don't need to quarantine if you've had your booster shot, are fully vaccinated but not yet eligible for your booster shot, or you're fully vaccinated and enrolled in school. But you should wear a mask for 10 days, and a test on day 5 is recommended. All others need to quarantine 5 days if they have no symptoms and will wear a mask for 5 more days. We recommend 1 negative PCR or LAMP test, which is a rapid PCR, on or after day 5, or 2 negative antigen tests performed at least 24 hours apart, beginning no earlier than day 4. For everyone, if you develop symptoms at any time, get tested, stay home and away from others while you wait for your result. I'd like to thank everyone who's reported their at-home test results already. You can see on our case dashboard the high numbers of what we call probable cases, which is the category that these positive antigen tests fall into. If you've taken one of these tests, please visit healthvermont.gov/report results so we can better understand COVID activity in the state right now. I also want to emphasize the importance of wearing a mask indoors. While any mask is better than no mask, we do recommend you wear a higher quality mask if you can find one as we face Omicron. Examples of high quality masks are N95 or KN95 masks, which are very good at blocking droplets. If you don't or can't get that type of mask, you can also layer a disposable surgical mask under a cloth mask to increase effectiveness. Just please don't rely on a single-ply cloth mask. Finally, I want to continue making sure Vermonters are aware of available therapeutic treatments for COVID-19 because they are so critical to keeping higher-risk people out of the hospital. But they need to be used early in the illness, certainly within the first 5 days. While the federal government tells us that supplies will be limited for several weeks more, some supplies are still available and are coming into the state. If you're at higher risk of severe COVID-19, it's important that you reach out to your healthcare provider as soon as you are positive to ask about therapeutic treatments. These include one monoclonal antibody requiring intravenous infusion, sotrovimab, and two oral medications. One of these, Paxlovid, has very high efficacy and has become the drug of choice. You can visit our website, healthvermont.gov/COVID-19-treatment for more information. And keep in mind, these treatments are not needed for those who are not at high risk due to age or underlying illness. I'd like to now hand this over to Dr. Rebecca Bell.
I'm really happy to be here today to talk to you all, so thanks for having me. As a warning, I did work last night, and so you will experience what my pediatric residents lovingly refer to as post-call Dr. Bell. So I want to just start by acknowledging that it has been a very challenging few weeks of the pandemic. With the arrival of Omicron variant in Vermont, COVID cases rose exponentially over the winter break, causing major disruption to schools and childcare last week. In the healthcare setting, we are feeling the strain of staffing shortages due to infected providers. In the setting of this recent stress and strain, I've been reflecting back to the beginning of the pandemic. Thinking back to March of 2020, when I remember driving to work at the hospital through completely empty streets, hearing about colleagues who had COVID and worrying about them. At the time, the modeling was predicting that we wouldn't have enough ventilators. We were worried about how we would care for patients. We were making plans with colleagues to figure out how to cover each other, not for if we got sick, but presumably for when we did. We were cleaning surfaces, but not wearing masks. There was so much we didn't know, and we were really scared. There was no community immunity, none at all. There was no infection-induced immunity. There was no vaccine-induced immunity. We were completely vulnerable, and we had to take extreme measures to keep people safe, and it was the right thing to do. Since that time, we've lost a lot, and we've learned a lot. We now have vaccines that are incredibly effective at protecting us from severe disease. We have additional therapeutics. We know to wear masks. Things are different. They're still hard, but we are in a different place now. Despite all of this, we are all tired. In the healthcare setting, we have a staffing crisis. We desperately want our patients to protect themselves with vaccination. Despite more vaccinated folks getting infected and more children getting infected, still our sickest COVID patients in the hospital are adults who are unvaccinated. Caring for critically ill patients is hard, and it's even more difficult when the illness could have been prevented. Schools are under a tremendous amount of strain right now as well. Throughout the pandemic, our schools have remained a place of relative safety with lower transmission rates than the community. And this is thanks to the incredible work of school nurses, educators, and administrators. COVID has put stress on all of our systems, but especially those settings that are under-supported and strained during non-pandemic times. Educators, childcare providers, child health providers are all trying to manage the needs of children and families that generally keep us busy 100% of the time. On top of that, we have COVID. Many feel like this is their breaking point. The work done in schools to create line lists and to painstakingly contact trace, which we don't ask other settings to do, was really unsustainable during the Delta surge, and the changing epidemiology around Omicron has made it necessary to adapt our policies so that we can manage this virus without letting it break us. Vermont pediatricians have been working through the pandemic to consider how to mitigate the effects of COVID on children. We meet regularly with members of the Health Department and the Agency of Education. We appreciate the opportunity to provide input to these teams. We also meet regularly with the school nurses and the leadership of the Vermont State School Nurse Association. We are grateful for their work and value this collaboration. I'm here today to share pediatrician recommendations for both the K-12 and childcare settings. These recommendations of note were discussed even prior to Omicron coming, as we knew we're heading towards an endemic phase of this. We recommend that school nurses should continue to have the resources to provide on-site diagnostic testing to symptomatic students and staff with rapid antigen tests or lamp tests. They should continue to have the ability to provide take-home antigen or PCR testing to these symptomatic individuals. A note here, school nurses play an important role in public health, always, but much like myself, they are clinicians at heart. Pediatricians rely on the work our school nurse colleagues do. They are skilled clinicians and integral partners in child health teams. They have not been able to do the work they are trained to do and is so desperately needed during this time. They have been put in the role of what many refer to as the COVID enforcer. And this has strained relationships with families and led to school nurse burnout. With regards to other types of testing, such as asymptomatic screening or surveillance testing, testing after close contact, these types of testing should shift from the school setting to the home setting. Students and staff should have ready access to at-home rapid antigen tests regardless of their vaccination status. And these tests could be used as a family sees fit. They could use them for asymptomatic screening if they'd like, for testing in symptomatic family members, for testing after a close contact, or for shortening isolation after COVID infection. We agree that given the shortened incubation period of Omicron, both PCR surveillance testing and that line-less contact tracing are less impactful and truly not helpful and should be stopped in favor of these other types of testing. For the childcare setting, we recommend much the same, and we don't want to forget our children in this age group, their families, and the early childhood educators. We support the Test for Tots program, where unvaccinated close contacts are provided at-home antigen tests so that they may remain in the childcare setting if they are asymptomatic and negative. We recommend additional access to at-home rapid antigen testing for children and childcare staff for the same indications as the K-12 community. I will note that one major challenge is that take-home antigen tests are not authorized for individuals under the age of 2, and that's a challenge that we need to work through. We continue to strongly advocate for universal masking regardless of vaccine rate or vaccination status. And speaking of vaccines, we strongly encourage all eligible to be vaccinated. Vermont has the highest rate of 5 to 11-year-olds vaccinated in the country, and yet it's only just over half of folks in that age group. Please reach out to your child's medical provider to discuss. You can also check out AAP Vermont's website. We did a series of virtual town halls with families, and they're all recorded and on our website at aapvt.org. I want to take a moment to talk to families with children too young to be vaccinated. I feel you. I'm a mother of a child in that age group who is in full-time childcare. This is an age group that frequently gets ill from respiratory viruses. What we are seeing in Vermont in this age group are COVID presentations very similar to other viruses. So when families ask what they should be looking for if their child is infected with COVID, it's very similar as other respiratory viruses. Most children do not need medical care, but please contact your child's medical provider if you're worried, if they're having difficulty breathing, or if they're unable to take adequate fluids as you would normally. I don't want to lose sight of the fact that staying home when sick is incredibly important. I know it's hard. It leads to school absences, missed work, and childcare challenges. But this is what helps keep our communities healthy. If you are sick now, you are likely infected with COVID. Even if you don't have COVID, you have something. And that virus could make someone very sick. We admit children to the pediatric intensive care unit all the time who are critically ill from respiratory viruses, non-COVID respiratory viruses that cause the common cold in most, but can make infants and medically complex children extremely sick. So as a reminder, all those above 6 months of age are able to get a flu shot. Please do, it's not too late, and please stay home when sick. As a final note, pediatricians and family medicine providers are very busy right now with COVID, with other respiratory viruses, and with the ongoing youth mental health crisis, as well as staffing shortages. It may take longer than usual to see a provider for non-urgent issues like sports clearance. We understand the frustration, and we're working hard to get your children in. We appreciate your patience as we navigate this all together. Pediatricians always value collaboration with schools and childcare. Thank you all so much for the work you do for children and families in Vermont.
Good afternoon. I'm Jenny Samuelson, the Interim Secretary of the Agency of Human Services. Today, I'll provide you a brief update on COVID-19 vaccines, testing, and hospital readiness. As of today, over 50% of Vermonters age 18 and older are fully vaccinated and have received a booster shot. For children in the age range 5 to 11, 48% are now fully vaccinated and up to date. Turning specifically to boosters, over the past week, boosters have been opened up to children aged 12 to 16. As has been stated several times, for anyone 12 years and older, getting your booster provides you the best protection against a severe case of COVID-19. If you are 12 years and older and it's been at least 5 months, which is a change, since your completed Pfizer or Moderna series, or 2 months since your Johnson & Johnson shot, you are now eligible for a booster. We continue to look for opportunities to make it easier for every Vermonter to get vaccinated and boosted. We've expanded the number of clinics in schools. By the end of February, more than 80 school clinics will have been offered in 2022 alone. In addition, we're providing both vaccines and boosters at as many as 30 winter events happening across the state. We continue to look for additional opportunities. If you are a business, a civic group, or a community organization and would like to host a clinic, please reach out to us. We will come to you. Our goal is to make it easier than ever to get vaccinated. You can request a vaccine booster clinic by signing up online or going to healthvermont.gov and clicking on your community. So whether you're looking to get vaccinated, get a booster, or just get tested, please visit healthvermont.gov or you can call 855-722-7878. Now, let's turn to testing for our youngest children. As others have mentioned, last week we rolled out Test for Tots. Test for Tots extends the Test to Stay program, which is already offered in K-12 schools, to students who are 2 to 5 who enrolled in a child care program. It allows children and staff who are close contacts to continue to attend their child care program during their quarantine period, as long as they test daily and their test results are negative. Under the Test for Tots program, rapid antigen test kits are being provided to regulated childcare programs. When there is a positive case in an enrolled childcare programs, family and children who have been identified as a contact will be able to test their child at home during their quarantine period. With a negative test, that child will continue to be able to attend their childcare program that day. At this point, more than 470 Vermont child care programs have already signed up to take part in the Test to Tots program. To participate in Test for Tots, childcare programs can register online through the Department of Children and Families website. Roughly 12,000 tests are going out to childcare providers this week, and we are also distributing nearly 50,000 masks to these programs. Meanwhile, we continue to offer testing for the general public. For the general public, significant testing options are available statewide through the ongoing PCR program as we transition to a more rapid system. We currently have PCR testing locations at 30 sites across the state. In the next week, there are a total of 25,000 testing appointments. Of those, nearly 14,000 are still open for registration. Additional sites and appointments may be added throughout the weeks in areas where there are low testing opportunities. Again, as more rapid test take-home tests become available, we'll get as many of them out to Vermonters as possible and as fast as possible through programs like the Amazon program the governor mentioned. Vermonters have done their part in so many times during the pandemic. We're once again, as we enter into this new phase, asking them to do their part. We want to be clear about when it makes sense to get tested in the current environment. Please get a test if you're symptomatic, you're a close contact, you tested positive and are in isolation and would like to end isolation, and lastly, get tested if you plan to visit someone who is vulnerable. Now for testing performance. In the past week, we experienced a delay in our PCR testing reports result system. Over the weekend, we became aware of a significant delay in reporting test results from the public testing sites. This delay, caused by a technical glitch in our reporting platform, resulted in up to a 4 or 5 day delay in reporting for roughly 8,200 test results to people in Vermont. These tests were done on January 6th and January 7th. First off, I want to apologize for the frustration this has caused Vermonters. We have resolved this issue. We expect the remaining people who have experiencing these delays will have their test results by the end of the day. Test turnaround times are now back to the usual 2 to 3 days for PCR tests. In addition, because of the glitch, 40,000 lab results were delayed in being reported to the Department of Health between January 7th and January 10th. Of those, approximately 4,375 additional positives were identified. Our data team is working to assign those cases to the dates that they should have been reported. When this work is completed, the public dashboard will be updated. We anticipate the testing dashboard will be updated and the numbers will be adjusted on Wednesday. Now, turning to hospitals. We are monitoring hospital capacity very closely. We continue to support hospitals with staff through a staffing contract with TLC and FEMA staff in hospitals across the state. To keep hospital beds open for those who need them the most, we continue to work to ensure that there are enough subacute beds to move patients out of hospitals when appropriate. We have opened 127 additional beds and facilities across the state. There are currently 91 beds open, staffed, and ready for admissions. We also continue to work with TLC to expand the pool of staffing available for hospitals and long-term care facilities when they're in need. As all data shows, the best thing that you can do to ensure hospitalizations are kept under control is to get vaccinated and get boosted. Finally, following the information you just heard on the impact of COVID-19 in Vermont, in the nation right now, I want to take this moment to emphasize the importance of every Vermonter having health insurance. Vermonters can enroll in health insurance through Vermont Health Insurance Marketplace, Vermont Health Connect, through January 15th for coverage that begins on February 1st. Our customer support center is offering expanded hours this week. Please visit vermonthealthconnect.gov to see the health and dental plans that are available, and to see the lower cost for health insurance through the state's marketplace. With that, I'll turn it over to Commissioner Pichek.
Before turning to the modeling presentation, just to pick up where Secretary Samuelson left off, when it comes to insurance, the federal government last night announced coverage for at-home rapid tests for all of those on commercial coverage. So Vermont issued a rule about 4 weeks ago that applied to all of the plans that we had jurisdiction over. We estimate about 140,000 Vermonters. This new rule will now apply to all of those who have commercial insurance beyond those which we have jurisdiction over, an estimated over another 200,000 or so Vermonters, you know, bringing about 320 to 340,000 Vermonters now eligible for reimbursement through at-home tests. The rule is very similar to ours. It is a reimbursement mechanism, although the federal government is encouraging plans and issuers to have a no-cost upfront option at pharmacies. Our pharmacy option is now fully implemented. So you can get reimbursed. It's just a matter of how will that work with your particular insurance company and whether they're set up with a pharmacy. So I do encourage Vermonters to check in with their insurance company before going to the pharmacy to ensure that they are online and ready to handle those claims. But this certainly will make a more uniform approach to at-home testing coverage and just another option for Vermonters seeking those important tests. So turning this week to the data, first, again, to pick up where Secretary Samuelson left off, we'll have a full slide updated as of probably tomorrow morning or tomorrow afternoon that we will post on the website that has all of the data that we usually include. So this is a little bit of an abbreviated slide deck because we don't have all of the granular detail that we normally would have for Tuesday presentation. But starting off on the data that we do have, you can see that for this week, Vermont's cases did continue to increase. You can see that they're up about 70% over the last 7 days, about 245% over the last 14 days. And visually, you can just see the impact that Omicron has had in Vermont. We're under the Delta surge. The cases were increasing, but increasing at a pretty modest pace through November and December. And then that much more dramatic increase that we're seeing here in Vermont, the rest of the region in New England and the country over the last 2 weeks. Taking New England as a region, there were about 380,000 reported cases in New England this week. If you take the estimates that infectious disease experts are using, that for every reported case we have about four or five cases that are not reported due to the transmissibility and the more mild symptoms that come with Omicron. That is an estimated 10% of the New England population that has had COVID-19 over the last 10 days, based on those numbers. So this gives you a sense of the prevalence of the virus at this moment. And it also gives you a sense of why there's an expectation that this will start to come down at some point into the future, likely the end of January or February for the country, because so many people are being impacted at one time. Looking at the next slide, another reason obviously why the cases are spreading as quickly as they are is the continued development of Omicron across the country and in the region. The CDC now estimates that 96% of all cases in New England are Omicron. That's up from in the low 80s last week. So now clearly not just the dominant variant, but basically the only variant that is circulating within the region. And then when we look at that impact that Omicron is having across the country and compare some of the metro areas to the non-metro areas, you can see that the metro areas continue to be higher. They continue to have more disease prevalence. And throughout the entire pandemic, these two measurements have moved at different times with each other, but they've always caught up over time. So we do continue to expect those more suburban and rural areas, much of northern New England, for example, in Vermont, to continue to experience more significant case growth as Omicron continues to spread through these more rural areas. And you can see that happening here this week with the non-metro counties up about 125% compared to the 80% for the metro counties. And looking at the next slide, you can see the nursing home outbreaks, the active outbreaks did increase this week. We have 10 active outbreaks, up from just three last week. So no outbreak that's particularly large at the moment. Our booster uptake is really strong relative to the rest of the country in our nursing homes, so that is certainly encouraging, but we want to obviously keep a close eye on that over the next couple of weeks. Now turning to one of the forecasts, the ensemble forecast for the country. I mentioned earlier how sort of prevalent this virus has been in the last 10 days in New England. The same is true for much of the rest of the country. You can see that the forecast that the ensemble modelers put out last night shows that cases are expected to continue to increase through the end of January, getting to over a million cases reported a day. But then the good news is that some point there, toward the beginning of February, the end of January, there's the possibility that they will start to slow down and come down across the country. Now, of course, want to note that that won't necessarily happen uniformly across the country. Some places have had Omicron earlier than others. Some places have different profiles in terms of demographics or vaccination status. But that certainly is some encouraging news in terms of what the prediction is once we get through the worst of it over the next 3 to 4 weeks. And the Vermont model is very similar to the national model, showing again that cases are expected to get higher through the next 3 or 4 weeks, but then at the end of January, toward the beginning of February, showing some slowing signs there as the impact will have been felt at that point. So when we get to the next slide, we'll look at hospitalizations. You can see that on the hospitalization front, overall hospitalizations, the 7-day average did surpass the height of the Delta peak. So these are the most hospitalizations on a 7-day average that we have experienced over the last week. That's a 34% increase. The majority of patients still among the unvaccinated. Today's number is 64%. Over the last 7 days, 55%. So that's the overall hospitalization number. But again, one point of good news in our data is looking at our ICU numbers. When you look at that case, the ICUs have remained flat this week. There has been no increase in our ICU numbers. Over the last 7 days, about 63% of those in the ICU are among the unvaccinated. For today, that number is 80%. So again, continues to be those unvaccinated in the hospital, particularly those needing the most critical care. And that's what our data is clearly showing and continuing to show. Also, jurisdictions that have had really high booster uptake have seemed to be able to keep the most severe illness, like ICUs and deaths, under control, even though cases have spread as rapidly as they have. So Vermont being one of the highest boosted states in the country, that's something hopefully that will mean good news for us here in our state. We're about 14 days out from cases rising as dramatically as they have. That's when other jurisdictions started to see their ICUs be impacted. So we'll want to keep a close eye on that over the next week to 2 weeks. But at the moment, good news in terms of the severity of illness that Vermonters are experiencing. And again, largely attributable to the high booster uptake that we're seeing in Vermont. Looking at the availability slide, so you know the increase in hospitalizations and other staffing shortages and other issues that hospitals are facing has impacted the availability over the last 2 weeks. You can see on the hospital side, those coming down, 58 beds available as of today. It's impacted the ICU side as well, although not as much, as you can see, and there are 11 ICU beds available statewide as of today. On the fatality slide, you can see that there are 7 fatalities for the month of January recorded so far for this month and new year, brings the total to 487 fatalities for the entire pandemic. Vermont continues to be the lowest per capita in terms of the number of deaths throughout the entire pandemic. So again, something for us to appreciate, again, largely attributable to Vermonters doing all of the things that we've been asking them, masking, testing, getting vaccinated, and getting boosted. So another fatality slide, looking at the differences between those that are fully vaccinated and boosted compared to those who are not fully vaccinated over the last 6 weeks. You can see that this has held really steady. We've been showing this now for 4 or 5 weeks. That difference is 24 times, so 24 times more likely to die from COVID-19 if you are not fully vaccinated compared to somebody who is fully vaccinated and boosted. And that data has been pretty clear through the Delta wave and into the Omicron wave as well. And again, you can see here why that difference is so stark and why we're able to keep our most severe illness under control at the moment is because of how high our booster uptake has been. We've added another 11,500 Vermonters to our booster ranks in the past week, which is great. You can see where we stand in terms of the percentage of our population having a booster shot, but there's still about 200,000 Vermonters who are eligible for a booster shot who have not yet gotten it. So that is really a critical step for those that have gotten your full dosage to go and get the booster shot to get the full protection. And then finally, just an update on the 5 to 11 vaccination status. You can see we continue to make progress there at 58.6% in terms of those 5 to 11 that have started vaccination, and 47.4% in terms of those who are now fully vaccinated. So again, nation leading, we'd like to see that higher, of course, and certainly encourage parents to take advantage of that as a means of keeping schools open and kids in school as well.